Hello everyone, I'm Norman Wildberger and thanks for joining me. We are talking about the sociology of pure mathematics. And today I want to start moving towards understanding number systems from an elementary social science point of view. So while mathematics has its origins in antiquity with geometrical interests and astronomical interests, in modern times, starting with Descartes and Fermat and this Cartesian revolution in geometry, we've moved more and more to founding our subject on underlying number systems. So we're talking about things like natural numbers, integers, which include negative numbers, and then also fractions, or we say rational numbers. But increasingly, modern analysis, like calculus, has wanted to invoke other kinds of numbers, which are more akin to decimal numbers, okay? But not finite decimals, but rather infinite decimals. And these are the so-called real numbers, which now, I think it's fair to say, sort of form the bedrock of a large part of modern mathematics, and which I think is so problematic. So I think there's a serious discrepancy between what our computers can do and what we are claiming that our number systems can do. And I want to show you explicitly and concretely, you know, what the essential difficulties are without getting embroiled too much in complexities of Dedekind cuts and Cauchy sequences of rationals, which I talk a lot about in my Math Foundation series. But I want to adopt a more elementary point of view here, and so that you can understand, even if you're a non-mathematical type, what are the issues. And in today's lecture, I just want to sort of initiate this discussion to give you a framework for understanding this very important topic. Okay, so 100 years ago, there was a lot of discussion in mathematics about foundational issues arising from Cantor's theory of infinite sets, which largely was supported because it was necessary for Dedekind's theory of these real numbers. And you should understand that a lot of the support that the modern abstract theory of sets and infinite sets gets is because of these foundational underpinnings that it appears to give to modern analysis, i.e. calculus. So, however, as time went by during the 20th century, the debate subsided and a kind of an unquestioning uniformity has settled across the subject, which is very interesting from a sociological point of view, okay, and really ought to be studied. So these days, students almost uniformly just accept whatever they're told about number systems. And they are, you know, told, well, we work with the real numbers, even though it's kind of obvious that they never actually see an explicit, careful laying out of these real numbers and this magical arithmetic that they ostensibly support. And correspondingly, a lot of students these days are blissfully unaware of foundational difficulties having to do with uncomputable numbers or non-measurable functions or curious applications of the axiom of choice and various anomalies and paradoxes that result from these things. So I want to address some of these things, and a good place to start, I think, is with a fundamental division between the discrete and the continuum. Okay, so discrete mathematics studies finite patterns and collections, and it utilizes natural numbers, 0, 1, 2, 3, etc., and then negative numbers, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and ultimately fractions also, things of the form a over b. And the fractions sort of provide a bridge between the discrete, because they're built up from natural numbers or integers, which have a very discrete aspect, but they model in some fashion the continuum, whatever the continuum actually is. So this notion of continuum is hugely problematic, as I discuss at length in my famous Math Problem 19 series. Okay, I talk a lot about the core issue with the continuum. It's such a huge problem in mathematics. So historically, the continuum has been accessed in an approximate fashion using actually not fractions, but rather the Hindu-Arabic decimal number system, where you specify a certain number of decimals, and the more decimals you have, the more accurate your statement is. And And that's sort of what your calculator uses, and typically your computer these days too. Although there's necessarily an aspect of approximation or round off involved with that kind of arithmetic. So it's not an exact arithmetic like us pure mathematicians tend to like to think about. And that's one reason why maybe it hasn't got an official position in the world of pure mathematics, even though this applied approximate decimal arithmetic is what engineers and scientists use to create the world and to do all of our fabulous technology. So pure mathematicians rather rely on a broader theory of essentially infinite decimals. Okay, that's essentially what it is. But the infinite decimals have some sort of obvious problems with their arithmetic, which I'm going to explain to you at some point. But pure mathematicians have then steered away from that particular point of view towards these things and adopted more abstract, sort of hard to understand concepts, and also harder to use concepts, like Dedekind cuts and Cauchy sequences or equivalence classes of Cauchy sequences of rationals and other things. So each of these views has different difficulties, but ultimately the same essential core problems arise, whether you're trying to set up a theory of real numbers as infinite decimals or as Dedekind cuts or as or as Cauchy sequences. And a lot of the initial difficulty really comes down to a fundamental problem of how do we specify mathematical objects and what the distinction is between a definition and a specification. So let me illustrate that with some examples. So let's say you have a finite sequence. Let's say 1, 5, 9. 1, 5, 9. Okay? That's a little sequence that can be described actually in lots of different ways. For example, that's the increasing sequence of possible last digits of an integer square. If you square a number and it's odd, then it will always end in a 1, a 5, or a 9. So that's a way of describing that list. Or maybe you could say it's the sequence of numbers which are less than 10, which are congruent to 1 modulo 4. In other words, if you divide by 4, you get a remainder of 1. That's another way of describing that list. And there's many, many possible ways we could describe it. But a computer scientist realizes that none of those descriptions, or perhaps even definitions, really is the essential core. The essential core of the object is that we want to specify it by actually listing the elements. Okay, we list the elements, 1, 5, 9. That's how we specify, really honestly and completely, this finite sequence. Now, when we make the big jump, or attempt to make the big jump, to so-called infinite sequences, okay, and I say so-called, I put them in quotes like this, that means that I don't really believe that this is a truly legitimate notion, but so I'm playing along. So let's say you have another sequence. Let's say a sequence 3, 5, 7, and so on. So we write 3, 5, 7, dot, dot, dot. Okay, so and then we say, okay, consider this sequence, this infinite sequence. Okay, clearly the situation is now dramatically different because we've only specified actually 3 elements and there's ostensibly an infinite number. And it's not clear to us what the pattern is. We may guess that, oh, the pattern is we're talking about odd numbers. We're just listing all the odd numbers. But maybe we're listing all the odd primes. Or maybe we're listing, there's all kinds of potential sequences that one could look at that start 3, 5, 7. So in this kind of situation, it's not possible for us to list all the elements in such a sequence. So we have to adopt a more indirect strategy. Okay, and a good way of doing that is to think about a rule or an algorithm or a procedure that generates the sequence and define the sequence in terms of that rule or algorithm or procedure. So that's the way a computer scientist or a programmer would think. And that has a lot to go for it. But however, it adds a lot of complication because now there might be a lot of different rules, algorithm, procedures that specify the same sequence. And in fact, we then have to start talking about the difficulties in deciding whether one particular rule is first of all well-defined, you know, because the rule may well involve English statements and or mathematics that's sophisticated that we don't understand. And then we have to also worry about whether this particular rule and that particular algorithm really generate the same sequence or not. You see, that there's a world of difference, I want to stress to you, between a mathematics which restricts itself to finite sequences and a mathematics which attempts to deal with infinite or unbounded or ongoing sequences. There is a further complication in that while most computer scientists and scientists would be looking for a rule, something that you can write down, some finite, you know, set of statements that generates such a sequence, pure mathematicians, for their own reasons, often want to be more general or more free. They don't want to be constrained by a rule. This is for various reasons, perhaps because they're a little bit nervous about having to venture into the land of computer science and dealing with, you know, the difficulties in defining exactly what an algorithm is, and especially how you decide whether two algorithms are the same or not. That's hugely problematic. But it's also because they want to allow themselves the freedom of talking about infinite sequences, which are not given by such rules. That's what this axiom of choice that you may have heard about really ultimately sort of comes down to. And so from a computer scientist's point of view, this is almost like some kind of fictitious thing, but it's something that some pure mathematicians really take as being very important. So here's a very interesting sociological point of view that really should be discussed. Why is there not a major debate, or at least a division in mathematics between those mathematicians who want to insist on doing everything in a computer science kind of fashion? In other words, always connecting ourselves with algorithms and procedures that can be explicitly written down and run. And those pure mathematicians who want to not be so constrained. Okay? There should be a debate. There should be sides. People should be on this side of the fence or that side of the fence, not just some sort of happy pretending that we're all in the same boat when we actually believe actually quite different things. So this all is directly leading to a discussion of real numbers as infinite decimals, which is really historically the core issue here. The question is, how does one attempt to create an arithmetic with infinite decimals? Can we actually do that or not? Well, it turns out that we can't do that. But the modern pure mathematician is very reluctant to admit that and to even have a debate about that. Because it's a kind of a core belief that we have to have such an arithmetic because people feel that it's necessary. So in the next few videos, I'm going to show you exactly what's wrong with trying to create an arithmetic, a valid arithmetic for real numbers as infinite decimals. And I'm also going to try to convince you that these alternate ways like Dedekind cuts and Cauchy sequences and so on really don't solve the problem, because if you really did have an arithmetic with Dedekind cuts or with Cauchy sequences, you could transfer it to a viable arithmetic with infinite decimals. And if so, that doesn't work, then those other ones are not going to work either. So this is very destabilizing. I know modern analysts are very loath to have this discussion, okay? And I think it's a really interesting sociological point as to, first of all, why they are loath and how the academy accepts that such an important issue is deliberately not discussed, and the real truth of the matter is kept from students, even though this is a crucially important issue. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.